Actually, there are so many misconceptions. When I started this talk, I thought there are few, but every time I start looking at these misconceptions, I found more. So this evening is an attempt to really cover some of them that have come across. Okay, the first one is Buddhists are not supposed to have desires. Buddhists are not supposed to have desires. Well, what do you think about this? Because the Buddha taught the Four Noble Truths, suffering, the first truth, cause of suffering, which is craving. The third noble truth is cessation of craving. And then the fourth noble eightfold path, the fourth truth, noble truth is called the noble eightfold path. Right understanding, right thought, right speech, right action, right livelihood, right effort, right mindfulness, and right concentration. This is a central teaching of the Buddha. But sometime when I travel, and then I meet some people, they say, oh, I thought Buddhists are not supposed to have desires. So that means there's some expectation of what a Buddhist is. So there's some expectation of what Buddhist people are. Of course, there's no doubt about it. That's part of our teaching, to overcome desire. But part of the problem, I think, it's English word. We still use the same English word for all kinds of desire. And in Buddhism, we find out that we have different words, actually. We have different words for desire. And of course, most people say, oh, you know, Buddhism teaches to let go of our desire. How about desire to have a job? How about desire to have a family? Ambitions? How about desire to have a good relationship? And then they say, you people, Buddhists, you teach how to overcome desire, but you desire to meditate. You desire to attain Nibbana. Is that not another desire? These questions, I don't know whether they are familiar to you, but they're very common. Especially desire to attain Nibbana. They say, how are you going to attain Nibbana when you still have desire to overcome, attain Nibbana? So they feel that there's a contradiction there, because it's about cessation of desire, cessation of craving. And once you have cessation of craving, you attain the ultimate goal, which is called Nibbana. So this is not going to be confusing anymore if you learn a little bit of Pali. So today, you are not going to have any confusion. The Pali word is called chanda, C-H-A-N-D-A. This mental state, of course, means to, actually it means wish to do, willing. So it has some kind of another word which is said desire to act. But when we use the word desire, then people are still confused. So I think the best way is to understand this word as wish to do, wish to act. So that's, it's okay. Like now, I wish to have my water. Then it's empty. This Buddhist commitment to emptiness. No, it's okay, no problem. Okay, I was illustrating, no problem. So I wish to, desire to have a cup of tea. Then, and then put down. So this kind of desire, the Pali word is very clear. It's called chanda, wish to do. Now, this word, it can go either way. It can go in wholesome states of mind. Whenever you conjoin another word with this word, chanda, it have some different meaning. Like desire for sensual pleasures, like we have six senses, desire for seeing, desire for hearing, desire for tasting, desire for smelling, desire for thinking, desire for touching. This word in Pali, it's called kama chanda. Kama there means senses. So when you put kama plus chanda, you get what you call kama chanda. So that's a different one. So we have to understand the word chanda in this case, it's approval. In this case, I would like you to understand the word chanda as approval, because we use this the word chanda even in our monastic tradition. When, let's say, we are going for any sangha transaction, and if you are not going to attend, so you give your approval, you consent, right? So we say, okay, go and get his chanda. So in monastic tradition, we still use it actually. When there's something to do, let's say confession, then there's what you call post Saturday and some monks are not going to come. So we say, okay, please give your chanda. In other words, approve. Give your consent. So in other words, when we say kama chanda, we are approving. We are giving approval to the world of senses. Right? You are approving your world of sense of seeing so that every time you want to go for sightseeing. It's not so bad to go for sightseeing, but I'm saying that you must approve. So you give approval. So then when you want to hear wonderful sounds and music, so then you approve. Then you put on your music the whole night. Then if you want to eat a nice pizza, wonderful food, Malaysian food, you approve. And then you eat the whole day. And then touching, we do the same thing. Thinking, also we approve the world of thoughts. We let the thoughts run the show. In other words, the thoughts lead us everywhere we want. We think just about anything under the sun. So we approve the world of thinking. We think about thinking. We get caught up in thoughts. So we indulge in our thoughts, even negative ones. So we approve. So kama chanda, it become a hindrance. It become a hindrance. When you actually not mindful of the object, then it becomes hindrance. But what's very interesting, it's again mindfulness of the same object that is free, brings you freedom, right? If you're not mindful of your thoughts, you get caught up in the thoughts, and then you feel exhausted. You start suffering. But the same object, you become aware of the thoughts and mindful, then you are free. You are not caught up in your thoughts. So that's called kamachanda. That's more of a negative in a way that it hinders peace, it hinders concentration, it hinders wisdom. But there's another word which is called dhammachanda. Dhammachanda. So dhammachanda is the desire to practice the Dhamma. Dhammachanda, D-H-A-M-M-A, and then you put the word chanda, which is C-H-A-N-D-A. That's called kamachanda. This is a desire to meditate, desire to attain nibbana. Right? So now you have three kinds of desire you should know. One is chanda, which can go with any other word, which you when you conjoin with that another word, with another word, then you get another meaning. All right? So chanda, that's the first one. It's just simply a wish to act, right, in Buddhist psychology. Then kamachanda is approving all the six senses. And the Buddha said that this is a hindrance. It hinders you from peace, concentration, and all the thing. And then there's another word which is called Dhammachanda. It's a desire to practice the Dhamma. So we can say Kamachanda is a desire to be desireful. Kamachanda is a desire to be desireful. And Dhammachanda is a desire to be desireless. That's the best way to distinguish it. So you have this desire to have less desires. This is okay. Now, it's okay to a certain stage, actually. It's okay to a certain stage because once you attain enlightenment, then you can let go. It's like a training wheels. When you are learning to drive a bicycle, you put a training wheel on a bicycle. And then you learn how to balance. You learn how to balance. Right? Okay? As you are riding a bicycle, sometimes you go this way, sometimes you go this way, sometimes you go this way. But once you have learned balancing the bicycle, you remove the wheels. Isn't it? You remove the wheels because you've learned the balancing. So you needed the wheels for training purposes. Maybe you don't do bicycling here. Let me find another example. Swimming. Learning how to swim. Learning to swim, especially we Africans, we just sink like a piece of a rod. I don't know why. Thank you. So I used to go to swimming pools and I see all these Westerners reading a novel when they're floating on it. I said, what they do? How can they do it? They were just in a swimming pool in New Delhi, in India. I used to sit down and I admire them. They were just reading a novel in a swimming pool. For me, I went back to the university in a swimming pool. I tried it. I was sinking. Sinking like, I don't know about our bones. So now, I had to learn using a floater, you know? When you put a floater, you learn how to swim. But once you learn how to swim, what do you do with that floater? Do you stay with that floater, especially when you become a very good swimmer, you are going to Olympics? Yeah, this is my floater. This is what taught me to swim, to float. You don't do that. You leave the floater because you've learned. So the same with Dhammachanda. Once you've learned how to overcome the desires, you can put down even your Dhammachanda. Are we together? But you cannot say that actually I'm not going to have any desire. Come and meditate. Oh, no, that's a desire. I'll stay home. Oh, yeah, attend Nibbana. May you attend Nibbana. May I attend Nibbana? No. I don't need to attend Nibbana. I don't have desire for Nibbana. Actually, you should know which word to use. If it is desire to come and meditate, study Buddhism or meditate, it's called Dhammachanda, which is called desire to practice the Dhamma. It's okay. Then if we are talking about meditation and or even day life, and you have desire to indulge in different senses, we call it Kamachanda. And we can work on it. We can work on that, and sometimes we meditate, and then we overcome these five hindrances. Right? So then you also can overcome that desire in different stages. To overcome Kamachanda, you must attain the third level of enlightenment. So it's unrealistic to expect all Buddhists that they have overcome, they have reached the third level of enlightenment, and say, okay, I think Buddhists are not supposed to have desires. It will be definitely yes if you say, I thought a non-returner is not supposed to have supposed to have desire. That statement is correct. A non-returner is somebody who has attained the third level of enlightenment. So when you attain the first level of enlightenment, you don't overcome sense of desire. When you attain the second level of enlightenment, you just attenuate it. You don't overcome it. You attenuate it, reduce it. It's only when you reach the third level of enlightenment, that's when you cut off what you call Kamachanda. So this saying that Buddhists are not supposed to have desire and Buddhism is morbid, you cannot have desire to pursue your goals or have a good family and all these things. I think it's not true. You must have maybe a will to study, to do a job and support your family. So then it's very clear there's a desire to be desireful and desire to be desirous. And also simple wish to act. It's a simple thing to act. So do you think I have kamachanda if I need this water? Kamachanda? No, it's my desire to to act, you know, desire to do. So if I stand up, okay, desire to stand up. Because I've been sitting here for a long time, and then I wish to stand up. Then you say, oh, Buddhists are not supposed to have a desire to stand. So please learn these words in Pali. They are going to save you embarrassment. You can tell people, okay, yes, I have little desire to overcome desires. All right? Little desire to help me overcome desire. And once I attain enlightenment, I will not need them. Okay, another one. Second one is Buddhists are paganists. Or in other words, Buddhism is paganism. That's not true. Not entirely true. Paganism refers to a belief in a god or gods other than the normal accepted creator god. So in Buddhism, I don't think we are pagans. I don't think so. So the thing about Buddhism, Buddha found out that the mind is very, very important. In fact, in Dhammapada, he said that all actions are led by the mind, mind their maker, mind the act, chief actor speak with a pure state of mind, and suffering will follow you. And also he mentioned the same thing, if we act pure state of mind, happiness will follow us. So in other words, if Buddhism have no God, Buddhism have definitely mind. Because it's still the mind to the Buddha is the creator, is the chief, is the maker, right? So Buddha placed high importance to the mind, right? So definitely that doesn't qualify us to be paganists. What do you think? Buddhist God should be karma, dhamma, or mind? Because all those are very important things to the Buddha. Because the Buddha actually didn't find anything higher than the Dhamma. Dhamma is the reality, is the way how things are. So it's really actually Buddhist follow what we call Dhamma. Buddham saranam gacchami, Dhammam saranam gacchami, Sangham saranam gacchami. So the Buddha being the founder who rediscovered Buddhism, and Dhamma means the teaching, and then Sangha is the noble disciples, a community of monks. So what do you, if Buddhism is to find a god, an equivalent of a god, what could it be? Because also we find karma, all actions, the law of karma goes like this, okay, it's evolution of course, but the Buddha say, reflect on karma like this. I'm the hair of my karma, born of my karma, live related my karma, live supported by my karma. Whatever good things or bad things I do, I'll be the hair of my karma. So it seems that also karma seem to be playing a big role in Buddhism. So what's your suggestion? Is it the mind? Because we find the Christian believe that God is a creator, isn't it? This is the belief that the God is a creator, but also we say the mind also is a creator. All actions are led by the mind, everything. So what could be Buddhist God if it's to have one? Is it the mind? Is it love karma? Everything is caused by karma. Well, everything is caused by God also. So now here's the question. we say in Theravada tradition that we have lists, lists, many lists, list of this, we list many things. So Buddhist has something to say about creating things. Actually, the mind creates many things, even in science. Yesterday I was talking about how there's problem is called pseudo-pregnancy. Pseudo-pregnancy is when people are afraid of being pregnant. They think about this and think, or the other way around, when somebody expect them to have pregnant, which happened during the time of the Buddha, there was a queen who was expected to have a son for the king, because the king didn't have a children, so there was a big expectation. So this queen became pregnant by just thinking about it. So the mind is very powerful, in other words. This is a medical condition, actually. It's called pseudo-pregnancy, whereby thinking about being pregnant or fearing to be pregnant, actually you become pregnant. And you have all the conditions like breast and tenderness of breast and all these things. But there's no fetus. So the mind is very powerful from a scientific point of view, from also Buddhist point of view. So Buddhists believe in the mind, isn't it? Because they say all actions are led by the mind. Mind their maker, mind their chief. Act or speak with the pure state of mind. Many verses you find out. So anyway, let us put this way. Simply that Buddhists don't have a creator God doesn't make us a pagan. Actually, in Buddhism also, we acknowledge that there are so many divine beings. We call them devas. Here even they have a term called office devas and devis. So in Buddhism also they are gods. They have their place to play. They have done good things. But paganism is not the same as Buddhism, all right? So if somebody tell you that you're pagan, that's not true. All right, everything's empty. Third misconception. The third misconception, everything's empty. Have you heard about this? Emptiness. This teaching, you find it mostly in Mahayana. But it doesn't mean that in Buddhism, Theravada Buddhism, we don't have it. It's called emptiness, sunyata. According to this teaching, everything is empty. I'm empty. You are empty. Is that it? Now we are meditating. We are all empty beings meditating. what's the purpose of meditation if we're all empty? This concept of emptiness is like a platitude. Huh? Yeah, it's empty. Everything's empty. Oh, there's no need to worry about this. There's no need to worry about starting a temple in Uganda. It's emptiness. Empty, you know? The temple's empty. Everything is empty. I give you a story. There is a nun, I met her in Brazil. She went to Japan to meditate in Zen tradition. This teaching on emptiness is very common in Japan Zen tradition. Then she had a very good teacher, a Zen monk. And then she was in a monastery. She heard about this teaching of emptiness. She was saying, oh, everything's empty. Everything's empty. But she didn't understand actually the real teaching of emptiness. And then the Zen teacher got a small boulder and dropped on her feet like this. He said, is it empty? Is it empty? You see, imagine a boulder, a stone landing on your feet. Are you going to sense emptiness? No, of course, it's painful. So actually, this myth that everything is empty and you're not expected to feel anything, you're not supposed to decide anything, you're not supposed to drive your car, after all is empty, you're not supposed to clean your car, you're not going, you're, I mean, this mumbo jam of emptiness, it's a little bit annoying when people actually don't understand it. Because people use it instead of helping them, it's not helping them, you know. I no need to clean my car, it's empty. Emptiness. Everything's empty. Now, emptiness, it doesn't mean a vacuum. It means that everything comes due to causes and conditions. Causes and conditions. And there's nothing that abiding independent in that thing. So in other words, it's everything interconnected, interrelated, and interdependent. That's what emptiness means. It's empty of inherent, it's empty of, okay, let us first say, it's empty of greed, it's empty of hatred, it's empty of delusion. Let us first agree on that. That's the truth. It's emptiness. Empty of what? Empty of greed, empty of hatred, and empty of delusion. Now, another emptiness is that there's nothing that can exist on its own. So it's empty in that case. Everything exists because of dependent arising. When this is, that is. When this is not, that is not. When this arises, that arises. When this ceases, that ceases. That's it. This idea of vacuum, that everything is empty, this is what actually the Zen teacher wanted to teach this nun. And she even still have a scar because she was not learning from it. She was not learning anything. She was just saying everything's empty. So I think today we are now clear about sunyata. Sunyata is no self. That's what we talk about in Theravada tradition. And emptiness is not a new concept in Theravada tradition, though it's mostly talked about in Zen traditions and other traditions. So this is sunyata. I hope this is clear today. So it's empty of nature because people think that everything is permanent. But if we really practice our teaching, we find out everything's impermanent. So if something is emptiness, it's empty of what we call nature. It's actually anicca. So in other words, it's empty of a self. So in other words, it's non-self. Are we together? This what it means. It never mean a vacuum as people thought or think. That's why Zen master drop a boulder on the feet and ask whether still things are empty. All right? Okay, another misunderstanding. Okay, we have finished that one. This is a common one. Common one. Okay. All roads lead to Rome. So all religions are the same. Same. All religion teaches peace. All religion teach happiness. Therefore, Buddhism is the same as other religions. Unfortunately, this is very unfortunate, we find these comments in Buddhist countries. People who actually are Buddhist, sometimes they come at some stage and they say, oh, because in these countries also they have other religions. So what they do, they try to fit in so that they don't actually sin separate. So they say, oh, no, everything is the same. Buddhism is the same as your religion. But that's not true. That's a myth, actually. I would say the truth is same, but different. It's when you are in Thailand, every time they talk about these things in their ordinary life, same, but different. Same, but different. I want to get this one. Same, but different. So Buddhism has so many similarities with other religions, there's no doubt about it. But we cannot say that because all roads lead to Rome, then all religions lead in the same place. Buddhism, of course, like other religions, teach ethical conduct. We have the five precepts, which are guidelines to live a peaceful life. Other traditions also have precepts. We practice generosity like other traditions. Even Buddha talks about heaven. But Buddhism has the teaching on Nibbana, which is its ultimate goal, that we don't find in other religions. So in other words, let us put it this way. If there is a mountain like Mount Everest, there's going to be a base camp, eh? And there's going to be a summit. So all roads lead to the base camp, but Buddhism leads to a summit. The ultimate goal, which is Nibbana. I got that one on the internet. That's not my words. But it's true, actually. Eh? All roads leads to the Everest base camp. But if you want to go to Everest, you have to take a Buddhist vehicle or lift or something like that. In many ways, we find even teachings that are similar to Buddhism. They are different in Buddhism. One is faith, generosity, even ethical conduct. This is a challenge I go through when I'm in Africa. They say, okay, you know, what do you teach? I want you to teach me something special in your Buddhism. People challenge me. Oh, you know, generosity. Oh, also we have generosity. And then I say, oh, you know, we practice five precepts. Oh, we have 10. We have 10 commandments. Oh, we practice loving kindness. Oh, also we have love your neighbors, you love yourself. Then compassion. Oh, we even help the poor. Sometime I was stumped. What can I teach people something new? They challenge me. Please teach us something that makes sure that your religion is different from us. I want to join your religion, but tell me that it's different, I'll join you. Is there something like this? Is there some money? That's what they say. They give me another condition. Do you have some money also? When I come to your temple, I need some money also. Two things they want. That Buddhism is different from other religion. Another thing, if there's something, they do like this. I don't know whether you have that sign in Australia. Is there something like this? So I had to find out what makes Buddhism different. I found out. Generosity in Buddhism, it is a support and the basis for the practice of generosity. In Buddhism, is this how it becomes different? Generosity is different from other different religions. The practice of generosity is a basis and a support of ethical conduct. And then the practice of generosity is a basis and a support for practicing samadhi, concentration. The practice of generosity is a basis and support for the practice of wisdom. So can you see where we are going? So there is no single tradition that practice like this, not African tradition. We practice just generosity. We practice generosity. There's no doubt about it. But in Buddhism, it's basis and support for the practice of generosity. So in other words, we use these practices to support and use them as a base for further practices, not in isolation. So now when we practice generosity, we practice for letting go of attachments, and then we practice, and then we meditate, and then we get what we call concentration because we have let go some of the attachment. And then from that base, we actually try to gain wisdom. So we are using, in other words, generosity to help us get somewhere on a spiritual ladder, not in isolation. If you want to make Buddhism the same as other tradition or as a religion, all what you have to do is to pull it out from the context. I give you an example, faith. We have faith in a Buddha. Other people also have faith in bananas, or faith in Jesus, or faith. Also they have faith. But what makes it different? What makes your teaching so special? When you look at where the Buddha taught faith, he taught it in a package. There's what we call five spiritual faculties or five spiritual powers. One is faith, another one is effort, another one is mindfulness, another one is concentration, another one is wisdom. Five in a package. You can't find anywhere. I can challenge you, go and read any scriptures. I've read most of these scriptures myself. Torah, Quran, Bible, African. Nowhere you can find faith in a package. Their faith, we have faith. But the only difference that makes it not the same is that the practice of faith is based on wisdom. They have to be an understanding. It's not blind faith. And also there must be effort. They have to be also mindfulness. They have to be also concentration. So in other words, the word faith, if you look at the package where the Buddha talked about it, then it's different because faith supports efforts, supports concentration, supports mindfulness, and supports wisdom. In other words, you cannot pull out faith out of the equation. You could if you want, but if you do, then it's the same. It's not going to be the same if it's seen in a package, its context. You can just bring any other teaching, whether metta. Well, other religions, traditions have also metta. Love thy neighbor as you love yourself, blah, blah, all the thing. Better even than us. But what makes Buddhist loving kindness so special? In fact, by the way, the word loving kindness is the same as loving kindness in the other traditions. In Hindu, they have it. In Christian, they have it. But what makes it so special? Then you have to ask yourself, where did the Buddha talk metta loving kindness? Where you have to question these things. If you don't question, you are not going to get it right. So you found out the Buddha talked about metta loving kindness in the four Brahmaviharas. So that means loving kindness has to have some compassion, have some mudita, appreciative joy, and must have equanimity. In other words, when you are doing loving kindness, you have to stay out of attachment, which we call a near enemy of metta, and also you have to stay out of anger or aversion, which is the opposite of metta. Otherwise, you are not going to practice real metta. Where do you find out where they are talking about loving kindness? Eh? Whereby they're telling you that also you must have equanimity, not to go to the extremes. So you can see the teaching on equanimity is guiding our loving kindness and make it so special. So friends, the myth is that all religion are same, all roads lead to Rome. The truth is that maybe same, but different. And Buddhism is different. It has so many similarities with other traditions, but we shouldn't just take things for granted. It's just saying that, Bhante Buddharakkhita is the same as Bini. Yes, we are the same, of course. We have a nose, we get hungry, we eat something and all that. But there's some difference. We have to recognize some differences, right? You're from Singapore, I'm from Uganda. So there's a difference already. But people don't want to bring out differences because they feel that they're going to be seen in a different way. Okay, I want to tell you something that I appreciate about Buddhism is that when we talk about peace or happiness, there is an address and it is also a map and also there's a GPS. That also makes Buddhism different. If Buddhism is talking about happiness, here's the address to happiness and here's the map to happiness. And here's the GPS. get on with it. Continue. That one, as far as GPS and map, missing some time. I just feel it's missing in other traditions. But the problem, again, we Buddhists, we have a big problem. Even when we have a map and the GPS, we want to ask the Buddha to drive for us. Oh, Buddhism is very difficult. I can't meditate. Well, do you expect Buddha to come and meditate for you? All right, so that thing we move on. Okay, another one. Metta, loving kindness. Metta, loving kindness. Practice of metta. When you practice metta, number five, when you practice metta, loving kindness, you are protected from poison. You are protected from poison. You are protected from fire and weapon. What do you think? This is given in the scriptures. This is something in the scriptures. The 11 benefits of loving kindness is when you sleep well, you have no dreams, nightmares, you wake up well, peaceful. Yeah, you are friendly to human beings. You are friendly to non-human beings. Friendly to deities. You are friendly to... Okay, you also have a serene complexion. And also you are friendly to... You are protected from poison, fire, and weapons. And then another one, you gain concentration easily. Another one, you actually die peacefully. And then if you don't attain a final enlightenment, you go to a Brahma world. Those are the 11 benefits of loving kindness. So one of them is when you practice metta, you are protected from weapons, fire, and poison. So is that true or is it a myth? What do you think? Try it. There are some incidences where actually people missed bullets. There are some incidences. We have them in commentaries. Buddha Gosa talks about people affected by fire and weapons. But is that the truth? This is a myth. It's in the scriptures, but it's a myth. The language we find there, unfortunately, it didn't say whether it's literal meaning or figurative meaning. That's called figurative speech. But most people, they take it so literal. Well, you are going to be in problems. You meditate here, and you say you go to fireplaces, and you walk in fire. Or you go to places where they have weapons and passing bullets and on overhead and all that. You say, you have been practicing metta. So for me, I'm protected. I can actually go to any war, you know. So these things you have to be very careful, you know. Actually, when you look at this teaching, we find out fire is the fire of greed, hatred, and delusion. Weapon of greed, hatred, and delusion. Then also poison. So this is actually figurative speech, right? The four unwholesome states of mind, another name for three wholesome states of mind is poison, greed, and weapon. Do you know that we use greed to harm others? We use hatred to harm others, to hit other people? We don't have bombs. We don't have all weaponry. We don't have guns, at least as far as I know in Australia. Maybe in the United States, people have guns. But we use anger to hit others. In fact, in many ways, anger is even more dangerous than a single gun, you know. Single gun, you need repairing, you need these things, you know, you need bullets, you have to buy bullets and all that. But anger, you don't have to spend a lot of money. You just get angry and blow it up and then hurt other people. So it's a weapon. We use it as a weapon. So when you practice loving kindness, it's the opposite of hatred, then you're going to be protected from anger. In other words, metta will protect you from anger. Right? The weapon of anger. So you're not going to use anger to hurt others. So that's the fifth one. But there are so many actually misunderstanding about metta itself. And I think another common one, we are still on metta, but let me tell you another misconception, unconditional love. And metta is unconditional love. That's a myth. In Buddhism, the only thing that is unconditioned is, guess what? Nibbana. The rest is conditioned. You want to know the condition of metta? Here are they. I'm going to read them to you. This is what should be done by one who is skillful in goodness and who knows the path of peace. Let them be able, one condition, upright, straightforward, gentle in speech, humble and not conceited, contented and easily satisfied, unburdened with duties and frugal in their ways, peaceful and calm, wise and skillful, not proud, not demanding in nature. You see? Let them not do the slightest thing that the wise would later reprove. These are almost 14 conditions. So in other words, metta is a condition, is a thought. It belongs to right thought. And in scriptures, we find it in a scripture, Majjhima Nikaya, when the Buddha said that all the four Brahma Biharas are conditioned states. They are conditioned, they are thoughts. In fact, he talks about in order to switch to wisdom and understanding, you have to see these thoughts as rising and passing away. This is a common thing. Okay, we can say it in ordinary life, okay, unconditioned love, as just as I told you, you can say half moon and half moon, full moon. You can say those things. But don't take it too serious in terms of ultimate speech. Because in ultimate sense, we cannot say that metta is unconditioned love. We can say it's boundless. The Pali word, you see the thing that when you know Pali a little bit, it helps you actually to get around these problems. The Pali word is called appamanya. Appamanya means boundless. That means the number of beings you can radiate metta to, there are countless. In other words, you cannot send metta only to your husband, only to your wife, only to your children. But you can send metta to all beings. Animals, insects, everything, kangaroos, wallabies, anaconda, saipadan, that's a dangerous snake in Australia, is the most poisonous snake. It actually looks so beautiful. I saw that snake last time. I went somewhere, I don't remember, near Melbourne. I saw this snake. It looks not so dangerous, actually. So also you send loving kindness to that snake, you know, the most dangerous snake. So the number of beings are limitless. Limitless or boundless is not the same as unconditioned. Most people actually make that mistake. Unconditioned, it doesn't equate to boundless. So the Pali word that groups all its mental state is called appamanya, which means boundless. So saying that metta's unconditioned love is a misnomer, right? Of course, there are so many misconceptions, I think, but that's enough. Okay, another, number six. Oh, time is running out, okay? Number six. The Buddha never answered 10 questions. They are called 10 unanswered questions. But again, the myth is that the Buddha, these 10 questions, most people refer to them as 10 unanswerable questions. 10 unanswerable questions. There's a difference between unanswered and unanswerable. All right? If you ask me, okay, how many Buddhists are in Uganda? Is that that question unanswered or unanswerable? Well, I can decide to not answer now. So it's an unanswered question. It's answerable. But people keep on saying that these questions are unanswerable. But just Buddha didn't answer them. You know those 10 questions? I think they are good for you because most people ask questions and you don't answer. And then you brush them off. Instead of going to monk or teacher and ask questions, then you brush off the question. So they are called 10. Who remembers the 10? Is the world finite or infinite? Is the what happened to the Tathagata? Does he exist after death? Whether the Tathagata, the Buddha, in other words, the Buddha, exists after death or does not exist? Does both exist and not exist? Neither exist, nor exist. What's like the soul and the body? Is it the same, the soul and the body? So they are called 10 unanswered questions. Is the world finite or non-finite? Is the world internal? Is the world internal or external? So they are called 10 questions, and also we find them in Mahayana tradition, there are 14. So actually these questions are unanswered questions, not unanswerable. The Buddha, why he didn't answer this question, there are only three reasons why the Buddha didn't answer this question. The first reason is pragmatic reason. For pragmatic reason. They are non-practical. Okay, now, whether the world is finite or infinite, what has that to do with it being happy now? So the Buddha said that these questions don't lead to happiness, don't lead to enlightenment, they don't lead to even wisdom. You don't gain wisdom by knowing whether the world is finite or not. So in other words, they have nothing to do with our current life as we are suffering, right? So it doesn't, it's not immediate to our practical life. So the second reason why the Buddha didn't answer them is because it's called epistemological reason. They exceed the way how to know. In other words, there's no way of knowing. There's no way of knowing whether the soul and the body is the same or different, or the world is internal or external. How are you going to know whether the world is external or internal? So to the Buddha, there's a way how of knowing things, either through meditation and you get to know something. So in other words, because for epistemological reason, the Buddha didn't answer this question. Not because he was ignorant. Most people think that the Buddha was ignorant. He didn't know about these questions. But he just put them aside on epistemological grounds and also pragmatic reason. Another reason why the Buddha didn't answer this question is psychological reason. The questions are already wrongly placed. In other words, it's asked, how many wings does your daughter have? We know your daughter have no wings. So the question is already placed. Are you going to answer that question if I ask how many wings does a human being have? Psychologically, the question is already wrongly placed. So then you cannot find answers to those questions. You don't answer such questions because of psychologically they're already wrongly placed. Okay. Number six. Number seven. Oh, time is running. Okay. Buddhists who go forth, they are called monks. Buddhists who go forth, who ordain, they are called monks. So in other words, Buddhist monks. We Buddhist monks. We, the word for monks, I got somewhere. They are called, I got it somewhere. Actually, the proper word should be mendicant. Mendicant. Mendicant means one who lives on. Mendicant is the one who lives on what we call alms. We go and get alms. Yeah. So the proper word would be to live on alms. Then it's mendicant. But still we call Buddhist monk, I understand it, but monk is more of people who live in solitary, and it should apply for female and male. It should actually, it should apply to males and females, not only males. So anyway, we accept you call us monks, but the proper word should be mendicant, because the word is bhikkhu. Bhikkhu means a noble beggar, somebody who lives on alms and all these things. But of course, don't start calling him a Buddhist mendicant. We can accept the meaning, I mean the current word monk, but you know that actually monk is actually somebody who lives a solitary life, I think. That's what it means. Yeah, so we are, some monks are not solitary in a way. Okay, so then the another word is reverend. Reverend. Reverend, priests, monks, Buddhist monks are not priests. Priests, usually in a Christian tradition, they intervene on behalf of the people, so and all these things, but for us, we are not priests. I see this word common again. Another word is number eight. Number eight is called collective karma. Collective karma. Like collective trauma, people who have collective trauma is people who actually suffer. No? So this one, allow me to display my ignorance. I haven't found this word actually in any text. But if you find it, let me know. Because we have so many karma, different karmas based on time in Buddhist psychology. In Buddhist psychology, have almost 16. Eh? They group them in too many groups, but I don't find it. But tell me when you find it, there's what you call immediate effective karma. This is Buddhist psychology, where I expected to find the word collective karma. You know Buddhist psychology is very detailed, but I don't find this word. Subsequent effective karma, indefinite karma, defunct karma, weight karma, death proximate karma, habitual karma, reserve karma, unwholesome karma, wholesome karma, wholesome karma pertaining to final material world, and then wholesome karma pertaining to immaterial sphere. Then there's productive karma, supportive karma, obstructive karma, destructive karma. These are 16. I never seen the word collective karma. Eh? Right.
Whereas if you're an individual or many, it's the number.
Right.
But actually, you could apply all 16 to one, or to five, or to a country.
Right.
So it's not a different type of cause, it's just a different number of karma.
Okay, but that's very good. Yeah, that's very good, but karma is volition. It's happening to individual karma.
For example, the cause of that karma is from being connected to 15 other people.
Mm. Right.
But we are just all having a result of it because of our connection to it.
Yes.
But it doesn't mean it's a separate cause because we are connected.
Right. Okay, so, and that's very good. And I think personally, I haven't found a Pali word for it in a scripture. But that's very good way of looking at it. But some people use it to hurt others, right? Oh, misunderstand things, okay, because all people have tsunami,
yeah.
That means all we did something wrong.
Yeah.
So we have collective karma. So I think when we look at the definition and stay with the bare facts, we can see that this is individually, we have to be responsible. I think that's about that. Now we go question and answer session. I think that's about it for today. Thank you very much. I exceeded 4 minutes. Questions?
Yeah, so if anyone wants to ask any questions about microphone, we can pass to you. If not, Sam will be going around passing some pen and papers. So yeah, feel free to should send in questions.
Okay.
You talk about happiness just now. You talk about sunyata, emptiness. Some people, I don't know, they bring that to anatta. So can you comment on that?
Yes, actually, anatta is selfless in a way. We can also, when we talk about anatta, that means all things also come to cause and condition, and then there's no self, abiding self, there's no core, there's no, even when the Buddha talks about the five aggregates, a non-self, he's talking about the impermanent, they are suffering, and there's no core. He gave so many similes about how the body is like a form. The feeling is like a bubble, bubbler, you know, bubbles of water. It's just bubbling, so there's no core in the feelings. Talks about perceptions like a mirage, you know. A mirage, when you look at the mirage, you don't find anything. So it's empty. It's empty of substance. Then you look at the mental formation, it's like a plantain. We can say onion if you don't know plantain. And then the consciousness is like, he compared it to a magician trick. So you can't find anything abiding, separate. So in other words, you can say it's a similar teaching. Why? Because when you look at another concept, it's alluding to the fact that everything is coming due to cause and conditions. The five aggregates are also due to cause and conditions. So in other words, you can see parallels to this teaching. You see? When you look at the teaching of Anattalakkhana Sutta in Sanyutta Nikaya, they talk about impermanence, everything, the five aggregates impermanent. What's impermanent is unsatisfactory, and what's unsatisfactory is it fit to say there is a self or not? So when you look at the Buddha's reasoning in that discourse, so you find out that non-self also means there's no core. There's no self inside there. There's no core. That is, people who thought there was a self in India, it's called self theory, they thought there's what we call something that is permanently permanent. Right? Even if you're trying to attempt to destroy a human being, that thing will escape either through the nose or through the mouth and goes and another body. In other words, when somebody dies, something will come out and then go to another body. So those people believed in the self. But when Buddha came and said, okay, when I looked at all a human being, I don't see any core within feeling, perception, or the... So he taught what he called non-self. Because the five aggregates, conditions. Eh? They're conditioned. They don't exist separately, right? They all depend on each other, and also even when you look at the body, has to depend on food, feeling has to depend on contact. So it's the same teaching. The only thing in Mahayana tradition, they focus on emptiness. And in the tradition of the Theravada tradition, we talk about non-self. What I see also in Theravada tradition, we have a full discourse in our scripture, which is called Sanyutta Sutta, actually. So we know that concept. So it's similar teachings. Okay, another question? Okay. Oh, I forgot one thing, Nibbana. Nibbana, a misconception that you cannot define Nibbana. Nibbana can be defined. That's the 10 thing they talk about. Nibbana cannot be defined because it's unconditioned, so there's no word for Nibbana. Actually, this is a misconception. The Buddha defined Nibbana that is the destruction of greed, hatred, and delusion. That's the truth. You find it in Sanyutta Nikaya. I forgot that 10th misconception. Okay, we go to question. Bhante, is it true that if we chant a lot, we will have a protective deva who will protect us from any tragedy? Ah, wow, that's very interesting. I think this is a myth. This is a myth that when you practice, you chant a lot, you have a protective deva. You are your protective deva yourself, or devi. Eh? You are your protective deva and devi, and what protects you is your ethical conduct, your practice. In fact, your meditation. So what's going to protect you? However, when you chant, it's very helpful because when you are chanting, you actually overcome. By the way, you know the difference between chanting and singing? There's a difference. Chanting is for devotion. Chanting is to gain for concentration. And chanting is to get wisdom. In other words, for education, for devotion, and for gaining understanding. Singing, you don't do singing just for education and gain concentration and all this. So there's a difference. So when we have seen what are the benefits of chanting, the mind can gain concentration, and when the mind is concentrated, you are not thinking about, you are not worrying about problems and all these things. So the Buddha talks about the mind is the maker, mind the chief, mind the maker. Right? So the mind is so powerful. So some of the things we go through, actually we think about it, and we imagine things and all the things. Some of the things can be our imaginations and all these things. So it makes sense when you chant, you imagine to be peaceful, right? And then you can be peaceful. And of course, if it's going to come, no amount of chanting is going to stop it. This is again equating it from other tradition of prayers that they will save you from these tragedies. So basically the best way, practice meditation, practice Buddha's teaching, and chant. Don't just chant and don't practice Buddha's teaching. That would be not helpful. Of course, chants are their places. You can actually chant and get some protection, but only when you practice. Chanting alone, it can help, but the best help protection is meditation, practice Buddha's teaching, and all these things. A lot of chant will have a protective deva. Okay, if you find any chat that talk about protective devas, don't disagree. Maybe there's this metta, loving kindness, and all these things. You have love from what you call divine beings. That's one of the benefits. Yes, you can have these things, but you cannot rely so much on this external protection. The best protection is to protect yourself. Don't accept divine devas to hang around your roof and help you, you know? So anyway, chanting has its place actually. It helps to keep the mind fresh and all these things. Okay, another question. That's it? Oh, I thought these all are questions. Okay. Now, is it true that if we chant a lot, we will have a protective deva who will protect us from any tragedy? Well, if it was so, nobody will have tragedies. If this was valid, monks will be very, very rich. Because they know all the chanting in Pali. When before you travel, you will just come here. So I chant for you so that the plane doesn't crash. But that doesn't happen. So believe me, I do chant, but not to have a deva around me. Already the devas are there already anyway. Yeah, so I think if you're a good person, very generous and all that, it will be fine. Okay, thank you very much. Okay. Anna, there's a question?
One of the definitions of mantra that I was taught by my master was that the mantra is a protection for the mind. So it's so the mantra is used to protect your own mind, so you have to do it yourself. So it's a protection for the mind.
Yeah, so that means when you chant mantra, they protect the mind. And what protects you from the tragedy then? Then what protects you from the tragedy?
But we as you said, we can't be protected from tragedies really, but we can be protected from our fears about them, first of all, and the way we deal with it when it occurs, second.
Yes, so again, it's the same thing, yeah? So when you chant, you don't think about other things, then the chant help you to protect your manas, your mind, because I talked about chanting for education, for concentration. A concentrated mind is protected from fear, greed, hatred, and delusion. I also mentioned chanting for education, because when you chant, you learn more Pali, and also you learn more Dhammas. Then it's that definitely that's going to protect you. In other words, everything now comes back to the mind. If a tragedy is going to happen, it's going to happen anyway. So no, it's better to chant. I'm not downplaying the efficacy of chanting, because I've seen it happening when my teacher was about to die. Every time there was chanting, the heart rate was going down and all these things. It has its place, but we are talking about the tragedy. You see tragedy coming and you sit down and chant. No way. If the plane is crashing, chanting is not going to prevent you from devas, and the devas come around the airplane and hold it and it doesn't go down. No, this is not going to happen.
Yes,
but
the neighbouring properties all burned down, but the Dhamma Centre itself, one of them was the What Buddha Dhamma Centre up in Mangrove in New South Wales, that happened. But there's four places in Australia I know that the Dhamma Centre didn't, and it was quite miraculous every time, but of course that has great karma with lots and lots of practice down there and everything for 30 years and for 50 years.
Yeah, actually I acknowledge that there have been incidences where this has happened. But don't take it literally. So that's what I'm saying, that we are talking about misconception and what's the truth. Myself, I was shot at and the blade never touched me. I know. So I've had some incidents, but what I'm saying, this is a common myth. People gloss over that statement and they think it's literal meaning. What I'm drawing at is, okay, with a few exceptions, practice it, but don't expect that, okay, because the bullet never touched Buddharakkhita. Also, after practicing metta, I'm going to be protected from poison. So this is what I'm trying to tell you. There have been incidences in the commentaries where people are protected. And this is even in Kenya, fire burned and stopped at the Buddha statue. But we cannot generalize. I'm stopping you from generalizing things, you know. There are remote incidences, and we have to understand when we practice metta, we are going to be protected by the fire and weapon of three mental states. Pushing it to weapons and all these things is stretching it too far. So in fact, if even that's the whole idea about it, then we lose the point. The point is to overcome greed, hatred, and delusion. So it's not, we shouldn't be sidetracked because Venerable Buddharakkhita was not shot and all these things. And then we just take it like that. Okay, that's a very good question, actually. Another one? One more question? Okay, if there's no question, can bring to a close.
Yeah. Okay, thank you, Bhante Buddharakkhita, for the insightful talk. So,
Actually, as we are going to slide into these things, the Buddha talked about if when you practice loving kindness, if you don't attain final goal, you are going to be reborn in Brahma world. Why would you not get attain enlightenment after all these years of practice metta, after practice metta? He said that you can attain to Brahma world if you haven't attained arahantship. It's because of dhammaraga. There's a word I want to introduce to you, it's called dhammaraga. Attachment to Dhamma. Also, attachment to Dhamma can get in a way. I told you, you have to remove the training wheels. You have to remove the floater. The last benefit, the Buddha said that there are 11 benefits, and the 11th one is when you practice metta, if you don't attain the highest, you can at least get a consolation prize of being born in the Brahma world. But they didn't tell us why we wouldn't be born in the, why we would not attain enlightenment. The reason is called Dhamma Raga, being attached to Dhamma. So then the whole